Good morning and welcome to Weekends with Whitney. This morning, we take you into the heart and soul of Cajun country. Deep in the Atchafalaya Basin,
I'll take you to this rare spot
you can only get to by boat or helicopter. Plus, the sound of Cajun culture with Grammy winner Wayne Toups. How this singer-songwriter has made Cajun music part of Americana. Then Dr. Nick explores the significance of roots, culture, and identity.
It's a good life, I'll call it.
But we begin in the bayou. It's an almost forgotten community that sits 12 feet under silt from the Mississippi River. Meet the man who refuses to let its history get buried too. It's hard to envision now, but this land used to be a thriving community. It's where Gene Seneca's family first laid down roots in Louisiana.
Ooh, they go way back to the early 1900s right here by Ushane, yeah. Came from Nova Scotia.
Is that right?
Yeah. Got banded from Nova Scotia and took a long boat ride from Nova Scotia to South Louisiana to wind up in these right here, in these same bayous, by Ushane.
They weren't the only ones.
Oh, that's where a bunch of the Cajuns landed. And they had different groups of them that landed at different places. Mm-hmm. It just so happened my family wound up at Bayou Chain.
Bayou Chain is an island located in the center of the Atchafalaya Basin in St. Martin Parish. The only way to ever get here has always been by boat, or now, by helicopter. Yet even in the early 1900s, it thrived.
Yeah, it was a community right here at Bayou Chain. Churches and three or four churches and a schoolhouse and a post office and a lot of homes.
It was home to swampers, farmers, lumberjacks, and fishermen until the Great Flood of 1927. It still holds the record as the most destructive river flood in U.S. history. Floodwaters spanned 7 states and 27,000 square miles, a third of it in Louisiana alone. 10,000 square miles of land across 20 parishes went underwater, 30 feet deep in some places. South Louisiana turned into a lake 200 miles long and more than 50 miles wide. Gene says folks living in Bayou Chain had to turn houses into houseboats.
They had to tear down the houses and build houseboats. So my dad was born in 1931 on a houseboat.
The entire town lived years, some even decades, on those houseboats.
Now, they still had the land. It flooded, but the land didn't disappear. Matter of fact, it built it up with the sand, so the land was a little higher after the flood.
12 inches higher. The problem was, it was 12 inches of sand.
You couldn't make a living. You know, the sand moved in and killed off all the crops. They raised cows and hogs and chickens, and it was just a hard way to make a living.
Gradually, everyone moved.
People started moving out. In the 30s and the 40s, by the 50s, most all people were gone from Bayou Chain. Yeah, my dad moved to Bayou Plaquemine, and that's where he raised us. But that's still home. You know, I feel like it's my home, Bayou Chain.
Today, this is all that remains, his great-grandmother's marble headstone. She died at the height of the 1927 flood at the age of 47. Everything else original to the town is buried 12 feet under silt after repeated flooding. Jean brought in these two grave markers, one for his great uncle, who died of typhoid fever at the age of 29, the other for his grandmother. They were born on the bayou and never left.
My grandmother's name was Addie Diamond, and she died when she was 25 years old, giving birth to her third child. Her and the child both died. And at that time, my dad was, 4 years old, and his little sister was 2. So my grandmother's sister, Leah Diamond, raised them on the houseboat, and then they moved to Bayou Plaquemine and finished raising them there.
But his great aunt and uncle never left the Atchafalaya Basin. They lived here, in this house, just a few miles from Bayou Chane, well into their 90s.
They got so excited because they never saw people a whole lot. Lived out here, you got to come by boat. Very few people visited, you know, back then. Everybody was gone. So they got excited to see us when we showed up.
Here the land has a different problem, erosion. When Jean first came here in the 1970s, the house was nearly half a football field away from the shoreline. Trees have disappeared too. The oak and cypress trees that once defined this area are mostly gone.
In Alab, my grandma's sister used to tell us stories about her brothers paddling pirogues under these big draping oak trees. You had to duck down to get the pirogue under the limbs. So when I did make my first trip, I looked around. It was no oak trees. You know, it was willow trees. So I didn't quite understand the story. And as I got older, I started understanding how the sand and the water moved in and killed the oak trees. Mm-hmm. So all the oak trees are gone now.
Cypress trees are especially hard to find, partly because cypress logging was huge business here in the early 1900s.
They cut just about every old growth cypress tree down that they could reach at the time.
Jean's developed a kinship with the old cypress. To get it these days, you have to pull sunken logs from the bayou or tear down old buildings like Jean.
Chicken houses. I started with a chicken house. Is where I got my start. Yes, ma'am. But it was some of the prettiest cypress I ever got. And just old buildings. And just loved it. It's the old cypress that lasts forever. Tells a story.
With it, Gene tells his own story. Over the last 20 years, he's built a cypress Cajun village right in his own backyard.
You started with a playhouse for one of your grandchildren and it got completely swept away.
Swept away. This one we leaned against was a horse stall at one time. Turned it into a gym. And now kind of turning into an old store now for crafts that I make.
All made of cypress too.
Tell me about the other one. So that one over there.
That's my woodwork shop. First I had to build a shed to put my junk in. I built it and I added on and added on to my woodwork shop. So that's where I do all my woodwork. Nothing fancy, but big enough for me to use.
He taught himself construction by deconstructing.
Many of them was built with those square nails, so I'd pull the square nails out of every board, which was a job, and save them for projects. But I think that's how I learned how to build, and then just kind of visualizing what I wanted and started. And it didn't come out perfect the first time, but I'm getting a little better as I go.
Going through here or out here takes you back in time.
I just jump in the boat and come by myself some days, sit by myself and think how it was, must have been like years ago. And just feel blessed that I get to appreciate it and use it today.
Gene's deeply rooted into protecting this Atchafalaya area through conservation and restoration, so everyone can experience this for generations. If you would like more information on that entire area, you can contact the folks with the Atchafalaya River Basin Initiative. And still to come, the sounds of Cajun music. Grammy Award winner Wayne Toups. Then Dr. Nick explores the importance of culture as Weekends with Whitney continues.
Satisfaction's our specialty. We really deliver on Fault River here in New Roads. Small town atmosphere, legendary service for over 60 years. Maggio, the only way to go. The only way to go, that's Maggio.
Nine-time winner of the prestigious GMC and Buick Mark of Excellence Award. Welcome back to Weekends with Whitney. Some artists elevate music to a new level. Even fewer create their own music genre. You're about to meet the man who's done both.
Well, I came home this morning and I wanted to fall.
Wayne Toups is one of the most successful Cajun musicians in the world, but he doesn't limit himself to Cajun. His music is a gumbo of Zydeco, rock, R&B, country,
and one in a million can be so hard to find,
and Cajun.
Infused it to the younger generation and gave them a chance to see the life of what Cajun music and Zydeco is all about. So I added a little bit of Southern rock, a little bit of R&B to it, and a rock and roll attitude.
He named that combination Zydecajun.
Let's go juking.
He's been playing the accordion almost 50 years. Makes it look effortless, but it's not. Even holding it is difficult for a novice like me.
There you go, put this up. There you go. Go right here.
Okay.
Each costs $6,000, but as you can see, Wayne's are customized. His on-stage intensity, exertion, and exhilarating performances have earned him the nickname La Boss, the Cajun Springsteen. He's played in more than 20 countries and entertained a worldwide audience in the 1990 Super Bowl.
And there's no one greater at Cajun Rock than a man they call La Boss. Wayne Toups and Zydecajun. Get it on, guys.
He's put out more than a dozen award-winning albums, but his biggest award is his 2013 Grammy.
If I can get through it without crying, I think I'll be all right. I want to thank God, my wife.
This energizing entertainer plays nearly 200 shows a year.
Are you exhausted ever?
I'm always exhausted. I'm a father of a new child. I'm always exhausted. But it's a lot of fun.
The man who grew up on a rice farm in Crowley, Louisiana, has mentored other local musicians like superstar Hunter Hayes.
I don't want easy, I want crazy. You with me, baby.
Wayne's also shared the stage and been featured on the albums of stars like Garth Brooks, George Jones, and Mark Chestnut, just to name a few. But his own stardom took a nosedive in 2005 when he went to prison for 10 months on drug charges. He says he came out a changed, sober, and grateful man.
You know what? I got another chance in life. I got a beautiful wife, a wonderful kid, and I've tried to stay clean and sober for the last 10 years. And God has guided me into a wonderful way.
God is good, right?
He's wonderful. I'm so glad he's in my corner.
He makes me
smile and cry the same time.
Faith, family, music, and making a difference motivate him these days. He's a big part of the Coastal Vision Foundation, a nonprofit dedicated to stopping coastal erosion and restoring our coastline. Wayne's also raising money and awareness for our most recent crisis, the historic flooding of 2016.
We showed everybody that we really love them and we care for them and want to come together. Now, there were so many people devastated. And, you know, we can only do a little bit, but the little bit comes from all of our hearts.
We sure appreciate it, guys. May God bless you.
If you would like to see Wayne play in person today, he is playing in Lafayette tonight, 6 to 7:30, at the Festival Acadienne at Creole. And still to come, Dr. Nick answers the question, is the grass always greener on the other side? As Weekends with Whitney continues.
In November, we will ask you to renew the operating and maintenance tax that funds BREC, your nationally recognized award-winning park system.
This renewal is vital to BREC's continuing success in our community.
It keeps the light on at all our ball fields.
And the water flowing at our sweatpants. It keeps the trails clean.
And the boogie flowing.
Go to BREC.org and learn about all of the wonderful things we're doing. And don't forget to vote in November.
Sometimes we as humans think the grass is always greener, and yet we forget to celebrate what we have and where we are and who's surrounding us. Dr. Nick is surrounding us this morning and joins us with more. You know, I was fascinated with Gene and how much he loves the cypress wood and Bayou Shane, and I mean, celebrates it and loves it. And that's what brought up this idea of our culture in Louisiana and how great it is, and yet sometimes people are like, oh, but I wish I lived here. I wish I lived somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
So why is that important to us?
Well, and it almost starts with what is interesting to me when we hear, oh, the grass is always greener, and we hear root where you're planted, right. Or grow where you're rooted, you know, stay in your pot and let that pot. That notion of the here and now, this is my culture. I think you raise the great question for me is, how do we explore the culture that we're in, particularly Southeast Louisiana, or where I come from, the Mississippi Delta, which has got its own very, very fascinating culture with great writers and great stories.
Oh,
and Southeast
music.
Louisiana having the great music and the great food. So I have to tell you, Whitney, that I, and maybe it's too vulnerable, but I struggle with this. I always feel like I want to be somewhere else. And I think the reason why I do it is because when I go somewhere else, it's always for a few days or a week or 2 weeks.
Oh.
And I'm having fun.
True.
But then when I come back from New York, I'm like, I can't live there. don't you think that there's some of that? And we
sure.
and we come back and realize that there's a normalcy to this culture as well. There's a normalcy. There's an ordinariness.
Yes.
To where we are.
Yes, yes, yes. But I think therein lies the comfort.
You've done great.
Thank you.
And I, with your show, I mean, I would think if anybody has the knowledge and the experience to really be an ambassador for Southeast Louisiana, wouldn't you say that your experiences and your the people you've met?
Well, you know, what's great is I feel like I've really been with the ambassadors, you know.
Oh, with the ambassadors.
I do.
Interesting.
Yes, yes.
Interesting.
You know, Gene Seneca, I mean, and look, he'll go, he was in New York for the opening of one of the seasons of Swamp People and took, you know, baby alligators and showed them, you know, woodworking along with Henry, his dear friend, and other things. And so they take that culture and share with it. And I think there are a lot of places that don't have such a rich culture as this. It may be age, it may be the different and the melting pot that this community has been, the food, the music, the way everything came together. And yet there's some people that can't get away, wait to get away from it. And I think that's okay if they want to experience something else, if they even want to live somewhere else. But I think the joy of being part of this, and especially people who were born here, you know, I'm not born here. I'm a transplant. I fell in love with it at 3 weeks. I'll tell you that funny story. I was in Brobridge at 4 o'clock in the morning. We were getting ready to do a two in your town. And they had all this food going, and they had all this music going, and there must have been 200 people there. I fell to my knees, and I said, I have found my people.
Wow. And so welcoming.
Oh.
So come and eat.
Yes, come and
such
enjoy.
Such hospitality.
Yeah, come along. And then that, you just don't find that everywhere. And sometimes you've said to me, because, you know, my hometown is Glasgow, Kentucky.
Right.
And you've said, but, you know, you don't talk about Kentucky nearly.
You don't
enough.
You don't. And but I think it's because you live here. I think there's a positive to that. This is your home.
True, but I'm telling you, while it's a lovely little town and it doesn't have the depth.
Okay, you're being even if it may be subjective, you're saying there are certain cultures that are greater than others.
Yeah.
That's okay.
It's just richer
but
and
I
deeper.
Think, but I would almost challenge that because you have gone so deep into this one. You have really explored this culture, and I can't wait to see the next show to see what did she do now.
Aww.
You know, with the lady with the mugs, the person with the wood.
Yeah.
The
artists and the
artists, the navy,
the Cajun Navy,
the plantation that you visited, the Whitney Plantation.
That's incredible.
I didn't even know it existed. See, there really is incredible opportunity. If you look at the Weekender from the paper, you'll see all that's going on in the city.
And what people, I hope, will do more is explore some of that. With their kids, with their family, with their friends, because it is. I mean, I leave an experience like that just so full. And it's really full of joy, full of gratitude for how much people love where they are, love what they do, love the history of what they've done. And I have had people say to me, which believe me is one of the ultimate compliments, of saying, wow, you did a story on that, and I went.
And I went.
And I saw it for myself, and it was great, because, you know, everyone will have their own experience.
Sure.
I just am lucky enough to be able to share mine, but I love it when they go and have their own.
Absolutely. And if I may, as we kind of close out, just go again back to the kind of the psychological.
Yeah.
Watch that the expectations are not too high.
Okay.
Watch that they're not too low. And when people say to me, as well as when I say it to myself, well, it's not feeding me or it's not nourishing me, that says a lot about me. I need to go and find places here that will nourish me and feed me and excite me. And if it happens, there are people here, there are a few people that are not LSU people. And I'm like, fine, there's more to this city.
Right.
It's a huge part of the city, but there's more to the city. I've got to question my own, and by the way, lastly, and this is where I really have learned, when I think I'm gonna go somewhere, mm-hmm. I have to always remember I'm gonna take me with me.
Mm. No matter where you go?
No matter where I go.
There you are.
There you are. Which means, what might I need to look at in terms of my attitude before I quickly say I need a demographic, or I got to get out of this culture, or this culture is this, or this culture is that? It's like, okay, fine, but you're going to take yourself with you. And wherever you go, there's going to be problems.
Right.
There are going to be problems.
No place is perfect, right. But if somebody is saying that maybe they're a real creative type, and they say, I have to go somewhere like New York City, or I have to go another, but where it's San Francisco, where people are more creative.
Oh, we've got them here. They just haven't found them.
And there's where I would almost say put your creativity to work here.
Mm-hmm.
If you're that creative, there's going to be a great opportunity here, much more so than New York or San Francisco. You want to go be creative, you're going to find a lot of competition in creativity. There may be areas here that haven't yet been explored that you can
really, really flourish in.
Yeah.
Great. Well, it is a fabulous, interesting culture. May we all celebrate it and unite in it.
And continue to bring forth the ambassadors for Baton Rouge to see. I get proud of the area every time I see a segment that's on this, and I'm like, wow, I didn't know that. So thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And when it ever feels real small, like sometimes towns and where you are can feel really small, just go out and meet some new people.
Amen.
Because there's a lot of those too.
Find a restaurant.
That's right. Great. Good to see you, Nikki.
Bye.
Much more coming up right after this.
Atlas Foundation Repair, fixing your foundation problems for more than 30 years while preserving and protecting your trees.
We just couldn't end this week's show without saying a final farewell to our favorite tiger. Mike Six was really more than a tiger. There was part of him that was human. You can read just the hundreds of notes that people have left here in just the past few days. This one, for example, says, I didn't get to tell you goodbye, but you will always be our number one. He truly was a tiger like LSU has never had. Here's a look back at our wonderful memories here in Baton Rouge with him. There will never be another like him. We will get another tiger mascot, and he will be wonderful. But there will never be one quite like Mike Six. Thanks for joining us on today's show. If you'd like to share it or watch it again, you can head to my YouTube channel, Weekends with Whitney, or you can head to my website, weekendswithwhitney.net. Have a great Sunday. We leave you with beauty from the Atchafalaya.